of looking up your old outtakes. Today on the docket, we've got rocks. We're going to start off right now with the two outtakes from the album, and these two are technically outtakes, but technically, as I talk about them, they may not actually be. The first one is a song called Uncle Tom's Cabin, and it is an early version of Sick as a Dog. And unfortunately, this will be the first one of this of its kind, as we have nothing, no evidence of it in audio form at all. I know that we had Sweet Emotion in the first episode, but we still have a version, we still have Sweet Emotion, but we don't have anything close to, or we don't have anything that's called Uncle Tom's Cabin on any Aerosmith album. I know it was an early version of Sick as a Dog, but by technicality, you know. The second song is a song called Tit for Tat, and it was an early version of Rats in the Cellar. And we kind of do have something for this one, because Brad Whitford revealed in one of the autobiographies that the original song, or the original sound for Rats in the Cellar, aka Tit for Tat, was closer to the song Searching for Madge, which I'll play a clip right now. This song apparently served as the inspiration, much like Blood Wind Pigs, See My Way from Mama Kin, and so on and so forth. And with that, that's pretty much all the outtakes, if you want to consider them that, for Rocks. Now, moving forward, last week I mentioned that there was a huge recent leak for Rocks. Now, according to my research, it wasn't actually that recent, but it gained popularity around 2018, so it caught wind very quickly, or it caught wind very recently, and that is called, is a bootleg called Rocks Session. It was leaked online sometime in 2010, and it features every single song on Rocks except for the song Sick as a Dog. With each song, there are small differences, and there are large differences, and there are no vocals on any track, period. So, I'm going to go by the track listing of the bootleg and not the album, and starting off, we have Nobody's Fault. This version of Nobody's Fault features no lead guitar, which is kind of a theme throughout a lot of these. These are kind of unfinished, or not unfinished, but they're kind of like, they're not polished, I should say. And the guitar here sounds really, really good. It's really, really like gritty and crunchy, and I love it. And it actually, this song features the non-album ending and the non-fade-out ending of Nobody's Fault, which is actually kind of interesting to hear. Moving on forward, we have Rats in the Cellar. Now, this song has the original opening, because the album version used a tape unrewinding sound, or basically, I don't know how to describe it other than like, you're like, it's like a reel to reel, where if you have the tape head pushed in and it's playing and you can hear it kind of like fast forwarding through the audio track, and then you push play, and that last little second where it slows down, it's like that. And it has that, it has no lead guitar, there's no harmonica, because there's no vocal track, and that would have been put on the vocal track, And this version's big, and this one is the first one with a big difference because they actually cut a large section of the ending off of the song. Now, this ending flourish is nothing new if you are somebody who listens to Aerosmith bootlegs a lot, like I do. This ending flourish was used on Rattlesnake Shake, Woman of the World, I think Train Kept a Rollin', Milk Cow Blues, Rats in the Cellar. They loved this little, like, flourish jam thing at the end. And it actually sounds pretty good, but I think I'm going to have to check this because I forgot to check this before I started doing this session. Editor, play the ending of Rattlesnake Shake by Fleetwood Mac, and if it's there, point it out. Otherwise, just tell us on the screen if that version has the ending version of the same one as Rats in the Cellar, because that would make sense why they decided to cut it, because they probably just didn't want to get in trouble or they didn't want to step on anybody's toes, you know. But, anyways, moving forward, we have the song Home Tonight. Now, I said that there's no vocals, but that doesn't mean you can't hear anybody talking, and you can actually hear Steven very quietly doing the count-in for this song. There is no lead slide on this song, and there is a slightly different solo than the final version of Home Tonight as well. Forward, we also have Last Child. This one is actually very, 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 very nearly finished. It's almost perfect. It's missing a few guitar parts, but it's very nearly there. Also, there's no solo, and it lingers a bit longer after the "with her face in the beer" part of the song. I'll play it here. It's very hard to notice, but it's still there. It's very minute. And small. With a face and a beer. The next track we have is Back in the Saddle. There's no lead. There's no atmospheric sounds at the end. I'm stealing that description from tapes from the cellar. So there's no, you know, bull whips or yelping and the I think they used halved coconuts to do the clippity-clop of the horses at the end. And yeah. The ending is actually longer and it fades out on this version, which it feels weird that it fades out. Next on the list is Combination. This one's also nearly finished. There's no lead, and somebody is yelping during the middle of the song. I'll play it here. It's believed that this is Steven Tyler, though it really could be anybody. I mean, in the next album, we will hear the song Subway, which had everybody yelping, but still, pretty close to being finished. Joe Perry song, so he usually gets these things pretty tight, pretty fast. The guitar players really have, when they write the songs, man, they really have them, like, like tight down. Like Last Child was nearly finished as well. Now we move on to Get the Lead Out. Get the Lead Out has the intro that's slightly different. It's just a hair different. I believe it goes on a little bit longer. And the second half is a little odd. There's a couple little differences that I can't necessarily pick out, but still. Next and finally, we have Lickin' a Promise. The drum intro has no fade-in. This is how the song would have sounded without the fade-in. And this one's also a little weird. And what I mean by weird for Get the Lead Out and Lickin' a Promise is that these songs, they have very minute differences. So maybe a riff will go on a little bit longer, or maybe they kind of let the verse kind of hang a little bit. Whereas in the album version, they cut it tighter so that way the song flows a little bit better and doesn't drag a little bit. Or doesn't drag as much, I should say. So both of these songs, Lickin' a Promise and Get the Lead Out, have a bit of a weirdness to them. I can't really tell, but you're more than welcome to put them side by side and listen to them and feel out the differences, because it is a little strange. Now, to discuss the tape further, this tape was likely a proof of concept tape, much like the ones they send out to record executives, which would explain the minor changes to certain songs with them being slightly unfinished. So, basically, this is one of those, if you've watched the Making of Pump documentary and you know how the Geffen executive would come in, I can't remember his name now, the guru, he would come in and he would listen to their track and he would go, oh yeah, this is good, this is that, this is whatever. Since they were making this out of their own record or recording studio in Walton, Massachusetts, they probably had to send these tapes in to the actual record executives to go, okay, well, this is a hit, this is not a hit, this is whatever, whatever, whatever. And as I mentioned last episode, since most of this stuff was, you know, they were already coming up with this stuff and they, you know, they had everything pretty down tight, there wasn't much to cut. This is probably right towards the end, and I have a strong feeling that when this tape was sent back, it was sent with a laundry list of things. Laundry list is derogatory, but it was sent back with a list of changes that need to be made and some suggestions to the songs. And these changes would have likely been the changes that made the songs into what they are now. And also some like, oh yes, you know, needs a solo, you know, add a little bit to this. Maybe don't do Back in the Saddle. Have it do its big flourish finish and have Nobody's Fault fade out. This and that and everything else, you know. And my best guess that this was recorded in early March 1976. Like this tape was put together early March 1976. The reason why Sick as a Dog is left off, I don't really know. Maybe, you know, they do have a habit, this band does, that they will write songs at the very, very, very last minute. I believe Walk This Way and Same Old Song and Dance were both late additions to their respective albums. But, you know, maybe that, or maybe this tape just, or maybe they just decided to leave it off. I don't know. The way these bootlegs are made is such a mystery. Like, the live performances, you can find out who the guy was, what seats they were in, you know, where they came from. Like, you can find out what radio station broadcasted this concert. Or you can, you know, find out, you know, the guy's girlfriend's name, who he took to the concert that night. You can hear screaming and whatever. But these bootlegs of outtakes and stuff, like, it's pretty hush-hush. So it makes me believe that maybe some of this stuff is a little bit more I wouldn't say dangerous, but I would say a little bit more kept closed-lipped, so that way to prevent people from getting in trouble. Much like when the Giffen executive that dropped the CD in the 90s of all the stuff from Get a Grip for $500 on, I think it's SLCD, how he was a Giffen executive and he probably remained anonymous, so that way, you know, he wouldn't get any kind of trouble from Geffen. But we'll talk about that a lot longer. I want to know why Sick as a Dog was left off. I really do. I really want to know why. I want to know why Sick as a Dog was left off. Hey, speaking of Draw the Line, next week we'll look at its 4 outtakes. But until then, I'll see you on the radio. Woo, Nelly! Hello, credits people, people who hang out to the credits. I see you. I appreciate you. I appreciate everybody. I would also, if you're here, I'd like to say thank you for 500 subscribers. You know, let's have the confetti. I have to edit this, so I probably should. Fuck it. Do the confetti and the little thing, whatever that is. Yeah, there it is. So, 500 subscribers. I am planning a little special for that. It's going to take me a little bit, but just know that I appreciate and I love every single one of you. It warms my heart to see that 500 people have decided to come hang out with me and listen to me gabble about Aerosmith and Air Outtakes and live performances and all the bullshit that they do. But I know last week I said it was going to be that one was going to be a short episode. I meant that as like it's going to be short as in there's not much to talk about. Like there's only like 2 outtakes every part. Hello, cat. Go away, cat. Hello, cat. These cats are crazy, man. But this week, you know, this one's probably going to be shorter in length, time-wise. But actually, probably not, because I'm looking at the recorder now, and it says 15 right there. But I have a strong feeling that it'll probably go a little bit higher because we're going to be talking about, we're going to be showing examples of everything from the warehouse demo sessions. So that'll be fun. That'll be a lot of fun. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. This one, I love talking about. Rocks is my favorite album besides 9 Live. Those two are going to be the two ones that I'm excited about and Get a Grip. But for the most part, I think that's about it. I think on a more personal, non-Aerosmith note, go see the new Beetlejuice movie. It's actually really good. I thoroughly enjoyed that. I thought it was a lot of fun. What else is there? Oh! Go see Tom's new band. Close Enemies. Go see that. Somebody go to that show in October and tell me how it goes. Because I'm trying to see ELO the 25th in D.C., as I make sure I make enough money, but please somebody go see them because I don't think they're coming to anywhere close to me. I think they're starting in Tennessee, and that's like 6 hours away. So I'm not gonna be able to see it. So somebody go out there, tell me if it's good. And honestly, the fact that they're all like, I'm pretty sure the only person who isn't touring right now with a band is Brad and Joey. Which is, yeah. Oh, and I think Steven, but I don't know. That man's in there for life these days. You never know. But the fact that everybody's still getting out and grooving and moving, it's good. It's good to see. It's good to hear. So, with that, I'll let you guys go. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the radio.